Hi, we're at Comic-Con with Nicole Perlman, co-writer of Guardians of the Galaxy. Welcome, and thanks for doing an interview for Showbiz Junkies.
Oh, my pleasure.
Tell us about the panels you were on, well, the panel you were on yesterday and the one you're doing today.
Yesterday, I was on a panel called Behind the Scenes of Film and Television, and I was on it with a bunch of wonderful women working in this science and science fiction, film, television, and web series industries. So it was Jane Espenson, Gail Ann Hurd, and Amy Berg, and myself. So it was esteemed company to be amidst.
What sort of things did you talk about?
We talked a lot about sort of the role of new media in exploring science fiction and what it was like as women to work in this field and sort of what our next projects were, what things, in what direction we thought things were moving for science fiction in the future. And it was just a really wonderful talk. We talked about all sorts of things.
Did you guys conclude what the next big trend's going to be?
I think we talked a lot about web series being more common in the sense that they would be that regular television shows would eventually be all online anyway, which is what they are, but in that way how it sort of blend with the interstitial web series that are made for fans and just sort of delving more into the worlds that are explored in the TV shows.
And then what's the other panel you're going to do?
I'm doing The Science of Science Fiction tonight. I did this panel last year as well, and it's a lot of fun because it's a mix of Hollywood screenwriters who do science fiction as well as science advisors and scientists working together to try and tell great science fiction stories.
Great.
Yeah.
Well, the opening of Guardians of the Galaxy is so great, and one of my pet peeves is whenever there's a lip-syncing montage in a movie, someone grabs a hairbrush and uses it as a microphone. Was it your idea for him to grab an alien and sing into it?
That was James Gunn's personal touch. Yeah, that was definitely his touch. But the underwater temple that used to be underwater and the water had been drained with the relic, and that whole opening scene is mine.
So how did you and James work on the script? Were you on first?
I was on first, yes. So I was I did 2.5 years developing it exclusively. I had I chose the project as the first writer on it, and I chose which guardians to be in the movie and what storyline was going to be, and spent a lot of time working on that and creating the relationships and got it to the point where Marvel's like, time to bring on a director. So then they brought on James, and he did his draft.
How did you land that gig in the first place?
It was kind of amazing, actually. I was doing a lot of science and technology-based screenplays beforehand, and I found myself being a little bit pigeonholed in that world, which I love, but I wanted to do something a little bigger, a little more fun, have more action. So I took a general meeting with Marvel, and they said they were thinking of starting this thing called the Writers Program, which they did for just a few years. But they took 4 or 5 screenwriters, and we each got our own office, and we were given the choice of about a dozen properties that Marvel knew people weren't very familiar with. They were somewhat lesser known properties that they were thinking of making into a movie, but there was no guarantee that they would. And we got to each choose one that would be our project for the duration of our program. So I chose Guardians. So I did 2 years just working on that. I did a little work on Thor. I did a little work on a Black Widow treatment, but for the most part, it was just Guardians. And then after the program ended, they brought me back to do another draft as a freelancer.
So why did you choose Guardians, and what was your familiarity with them in the comics?
Well, I wasn't familiar with them to begin with, but I really wanted to do science fiction. And Guardians was the most science fiction of all the properties that were on that list. So I was very drawn to the idea of an ensemble cast. I was drawn to the idea of exploring Cosmic Marvel for sort of the first Cosmic Marvel movie that Marvel Studios would be making. And I really wanted to play in that world. It was a lot of fun. And I also really liked the tone of the comics. The comics were very fun and sarcastic, and I was drawn to that.
Did you work on a Black Widow treatment before she was in the Iron Man movies?
I was working on it at the same time that Iron Man 2 was filming, and then off and on for another year or so. But it was pretty apparent that they wanted me to work primarily on Guardians.
Yeah. And what were your contributions to Thor?
Oh, I was brought in to work on Natalie Portman's scenes. So I did the scientist, exactly. They're like, oh, we have a science loving writer on staff, and you know, they basically had everybody in the program take a stab at doing a rewrite and doing a very quick polish, and they liked my polish the best, so they brought me in to do some rewriting scenes for Natalie's dialogue. It was fun.
So with Guardians, how did you decide which characters like Yanzo and Rocket would get Earth-slaying, characters like Gamora and Drax didn't?
Would get?
Earth-slaying.
Oh, well, you know, I think Drax's culture doesn't get colloquialism, so I think it's just a question of who they interact with throughout their lives. I mean, but it's actually in Drax's species that they don't understand metaphor. So whereas other species can pick them up based on who they meet with. But yes, Earth-slaying is a big part of the movie, so it would be a little sad if only Peter Quill understood the Earth-slaying. But actually, Rocket has his own slang as well. You know, he's dropping alien slang every so often, too.
Did you write out the beats of the action scenes, or just let the CGI handle it?
No, usually when you write screenplays, you write out the beats. And I think things change when you go into production. You get fight choreographers and things like that for, you know, in-person combat scenes. But yeah, the big action set pieces you write out. Yeah.
Was the Footloose riff in your draft, or is that James?
I had a lot of 80s pop references in my draft, but the specific Footloose one was James.
And what about the Blacklight joke?
I keep getting asked that question. that was also James.
Well, there are a good number of dick jokes.
Yes, there are. Okay. There definitely are. And my, you know, my take on Rocket was also very raunchy. And Rocket's a raunchy character. If you look at the 2008 comic books, they are very, they've got a fun sort of raunchy vibe to them.
Was it tough to think of ways to utilize all of Groot's unique powers?
Actually, that was something I really enjoyed doing. And I don't know if I should talk about them because they're spoilers for the movie, but... coming up with ways to make the tree element of his physical body be very expressive, and in the trailer, it's not a spoiler because in the trailer you see him releasing phosphorescent spores, and that scene I thought they really brought the scene that I thought up to life in a beautiful way, like just absolutely stunning. So especially with 3D, I thought that looked really good. But in the third act climax, some of the actions that Groot takes that I don't know if I should give away, I thought they brought that to life so beautifully. I was really moved by how wonderfully it came out.
So are you still working in Marvel scripts?
No, I have other projects that I'm working on right now. I've got a science fiction project at DreamWorks, a television pilot at Skydance, and a original fantasy feature that I'm developing with Cirque du Soleil.
So in success, if there's a Guardians 2, mm-hmm. is that now James' territory?
It's probably James' territory, but I would be surprised if I don't work with Marvel again in the future. We've got a good relationship.
What's the DreamWorks science fiction?
It's an adaptation of a book called The Fire Sermon that comes out next year. Yeah, it's sort of a dark science fiction tale.
So you must have read it in galleys.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I read the manuscript.
What was the appeal to you? What's the science concept?
It's post-apocalyptic, but it's very much about genetics and twins. It's about what appeals to me is the brother-sister relationship. It's a lot about sibling rivalry, which I can definitely relate to. But it's a whole lot of science related to how... following a nuclear apocalypse, it might affect our genome, and in not exactly X-Men type ways, but a little darker than that. But it's everybody is born with a twin, and some of the twins have unique abilities.
Well, I love post-apocalyptic stories. Mm-hmm. I'm not familiar with that book, but my favorite part is when they have to find supplies in the wasteland and the wreckage.
Yeah.
So it sounds like there's a more genetic angle to that, but does the book indicate, and are you indicating what supplies people might find in the remains of civilization?
Well, it's been a while. It's been several centuries after this has happened, but yeah, there's definitely ruins, and it's kind of interesting that the culture has begun to view anything that was technological as sort of taboo, because that was linked to the end of the world, pretty much, you know, the nuclear apocalypse. So if you find old, you know, iPods and things like that, they're considered like very, very taboo. Nobody, very superstitious. You don't want to go anywhere near them. So it's sort of reverted back to about like a medieval, feudal state in some ways. But the book comes out next year, so it's called The Fire Sermon. So keep your eyes peeled.
What's the Cirque du Soleil film?
That's an original idea that I have been developing with Cirque. And it's not a circus movie. It's an updated Pandora's Box retelling of the fable. And it's kind of Labyrinth in tone or Alice in Wonderland.
Labyrinth?
Similar to Jim, yes, in that vibe, that tone with strange creatures and a coming of age story for a 14-year-old girl who goes on this adventure and has to fight a lot of demons and wage all sorts of battles, but lending their aesthetic and their sort of creative brand to a very unique visual world.
Are there roles for their performers in it?
Yes, Cirque's performers, if you've seen the shows, they don't speak very much. They tend to speak sort of Cirque gibberish. So the main roles would be for normal Hollywood actors, but the secondary roles would very much be available for the physicality, sort of Andy Serkis like. He brought Gollum's character to life with his physical transformations. I think that a lot of the Cirque performers could do that for the secondary roles for sure.
Right, they're acrobats.
Right, and a lot of these secondary roles are sort of otherworldly creatures. Yeah.
Was there a third upcoming film?
It's a pilot, a television pilot, and that is at Skydance. And Neil Berger is executive producing and directing, and I'm just writing the pilot now, so we haven't brought it to networks or cable. But it's an adaptation of a British book series called the Matthew Swift series that was written by Kat Griffin. There's a bunch of books in the series, and that's sort of a dark urban magic. It's wizards, but there's drug rings, prostitution circles. It's kind of like mafia, but a very cool, rich world that takes place in modern London.
Maybe, I don't know if you've progressed far enough to know this yet, but would the pilot be up to a certain number of chapters in the first book?
It would probably cover, we've talked about it, and it's probably going to cover the majority of the setup for the first book. So the basic premise, the basic, I would say, I don't know how many chapters, I guess like the first half, maybe first 10 chapters cover it, because it's a lot of exposition in the book, and it doesn't always line up perfectly with action for screenplays.
Yeah, the first act.
Yeah, it's about the first act. The book is quite long, so we're picking and choosing various parts throughout the book to incorporate into the pilot. It's hard to line it up with chapters, exactly.
Well, congratulations on Guardians of the Galaxy. I'm sure you've seen it's going over tremendously.
Yes.
And welcome back to Comic-Con.
Great. Thank you so much. It was nice to sit with you.